This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Charles Curtis, January 25, 1860. Managing legislation and accomplishing Republican national goals. Curtis ran for vice president with Herbert Hoover as president in 1928. They won a landslide victory, although they ran again in 1932. The voters, feeling Hoover had failed to alleviate the Great Depression, elected Democrats Franklin D. Roosevelt and John Nance Garner. Contents 1. Early life and education. 2. Marriage and family. 3. Political career. 31. Representative. 32. U.S. Senator. 33. Vice President of the United States. 4. Later years. 5. After politics. 6. Legacy and honors. 7. See also. 8. References. 9. External links. Early life and education. Born on January 25, 1860 in Topeka, Kansas Territory, prior to its admission as a state in January 1861, Charles Curtis had considerable American Indian ancestry. His mother Ellen Papin, also spelled Papin, was Ka, Osage, Potawatomi, and French. His father Orrin Curtis was of English, Scots, and Welsh ancestry on his mother's side. Curtis was a descendant of Chief White Plume of the Ka Nation and Chief Pawhuska of the Osage. Curtis's first words as an infant were in French and Kanza, learned from his mother. She died when he was 3, but he lived for some time with her parents on the Ka Reservation and returned to them in later years. He learned to love racing horses. Later he was a highly successful jockey in prairie horse races. On June 1, 1868, 100 Cheyenne warriors invaded the Ka Reservation. Terrified white settlers took refuge in nearby Council Grove. The Ka men painted their faces, donned regalia, and rode out on horseback to confront the Cheyenne. The rival Indian warriors put on display of superb horsemanship, accompanied with war cries and volleys of bullets and arrows. After about 4 hours, the Cheyenne retired with a few stolen horses and a peace offering of coffee and sugar from the Council Grove merchants. No one had been injured on either side during the battle. Joe Jim, a Ka interpreter, galloped 60 miles to Topeka to seek assistance from the governor. Riding with Joe Jim was 8-year-old Charles Curtis, then nicknamed Indian Charlie after Curtis's mother's death in 1863. His father remarried but soon divorced. Orrin Curtis was captured and imprisoned during his Civil War service, and during this period, the infant Charles was cared for by his maternal grandparents. They helped him gain possession of his mother's land in North Topeka, which, in the Ka matrilineal system, he inherited from her. His father tried unsuccessfully to get control of this land. Orrin Curtis married a third time and had a daughter, Teresa Permelia Dolly Curtis, born in 1866. After the war, Curtis was strongly influenced by both sets of grandparents. After living on the reservation with his maternal grandparents, M. Papin and Julie Gonville, he returned to Topeka. He lived with his paternal grandparents while attending Topeka High School. Both grandmothers encouraged his education. Curtis read law in an established firm where he worked part-time. He was admitted to the bar in 1881, and began his practice in Topeka. He served as prosecuting attorney of Shawnee County, Kansas from 1885 to 1889. Marriage and family. On November 27, 1884, Charles Curtis married Annie Elizabeth Baird, 1860 to 1924. They had 3 children: Permelia Jeanette Curtis, 1886 to 1955, Harry King Curtis, 1890 to 1946, and Leona Virginia Curtis, 1892 to 1965. He and his wife also provided a home in Topeka for his half-sister Teresa Permelia Dolly Curtis. Before her marriage, his wife died in 1924, a widower. When elected vice president in 1928, Curtis had his half-sister Dolly Curtis. Gan, March 1866 to January 30, 1953, act as his official hostess for social events. She had lived with her husband Edward Everett Gan in Washington, D.C. since about 1903. He was a lawyer and at one time an assistant attorney general in the government attuned to social protocol. Dolly Gan insisted in 1929 on being treated officially as the number 2 woman in government at social functions, and the diplomatic corps voted to change a State Department protocol to acknowledge this while her brother was in office. To date, Curtis is the last vice president to be unmarried. During his entire time in office, Alban W. Barkley, who served as vice president from 1949 to 1953, entered office as a widower. He remarried while in office. Political career. This section needs additional citations for verification. Please help improve this article by adding citations to reliable sources. Unsourced material may be challenged and removed. January 2013. Learn how and when to remove this template message. Representative first elected as a Republican to the House of Representatives of the 53rd Congress, Curtis was re-elected for the following six terms. He made the effort to learn about his many constituents and treated them as personal friends. Charles Curtis's vice presidential bust. While serving as a representative, Curtis sponsored and helped pass the Curtis Act of 1898. It extended the Dawes Act to the five civilized tribes of Indian Territory as such. It ended their self-government and provided for allotment of communal land to individual households of tribal members. To be recorded on official rolls, it limited their tribal courts and government. Any lands not allotted were to be considered surplus and were sold to non-natives. Based on his personal experience, Curtis believed that Indians could benefit by getting educated, assimilating, and joining the main society. Implementation of this act completed the extinguishing of tribal land titles in Indian Territory, preparing it to be admitted as the state of Oklahoma, which was done in 1907. The government tried to encourage Indians to accept individual citizenship and lands, and to take up European American culture. By the end of the century, it had set up boarding schools for Indian children as another method of assimilation. Curtis re-enrolled in the Kaw Nation, which had been removed from Kansas to Indian Territory, now Oklahoma, when he was in his teens in 1902. The Kaw Allotment Act disbanded the Kaw Nation as a legal entity and provided for the allotment of communal land to members, in a process similar to that endured by other tribes. The act transferred 160 to individual tribal members under the terms of the act. As enrolled tribal members, Curtis and his three children were allotted about 1,625. Conference. He also was elected for a decade as Senate Minority Whip and for 4 years as Senate Majority Leader after Republicans won control of the chamber. Thus he held all the senior leadership positions in the Senate and was highly respected for his ability to work with members on both sides of the aisle. In 1923, Senator Curtis, together with fellow Kansan, Representative Daniel Reed Anthony Jr., proposed the first version of the Equal Rights Amendment to the United States Constitution to each of their houses. The amendment did not go forward. Curtis's leadership abilities were demonstrated by his election as Republican Whip from 1915 to 1924 and Majority Leader from 1925 to 1929. He was effective in collaboration and moving legislation forward in the Senate. Idaho Senator William Bora acclaimed Curtis as a great reconciler, a walking political encyclopedia, and one of the best political poker players in America. Time magazine featured him on the cover in December 1926 and reported, "It is in the party caucuses, in the committee rooms, in the cloakrooms that he patches up troubles, puts through legislation." As one of the two leading senators, with Reed Smoot, Curtis was remembered for not making many speeches. He was noted for keeping the best card index of the state ever made. Curtis used a black notebook, and later a card index, to record all the people he met while in office or campaigning, and continually referred to it, resulting in his being known for his remarkable memory for faces and names. Never a pension letter, or any other letter for that matter, came in that wasn't answered promptly, and another name went into the all-embracing card index. The doctors were listed, the farm leaders, the school teachers. The lists were kept up to date. How such an intricate index could be kept up to date and function so smoothly was a marvel to his associates. It was one of Curtis's prides. Curtis was celebrated as a stand patter, the most regular of Republicans, and yet a man who could always bargain with his party's progressives and with senators from across the center aisle. Newspapers claimed that Curtis knew the Senate rules better than any other senator and declared him the most competent man in Congress to look after the legislative program of the administration. Vice President of the United States, President Calvin Coolidge, First Lady Grace Coolidge, and Senator Curtis on their way to the Capitol building on Inauguration Day, March 4, 1920. In 1928, Curtis was the Republican candidate for vice president. As running mate to Herbert Hoover, they won in a landslide, 58% to 41%. Curtis resigned from the Senate to assume his new office. Curtis arranged for a Native American jazz band to perform at the inauguration on the 4th of March 1929, soon after the Great Depression began. Curtis endorsed the five-day work week, with no reduction in wages, as a work-sharing solution to unemployment. He was 69 when he took office, making him the second oldest vice president to date, behind Alvin W. Barkley at 71. Curtis's election as vice president made history because he was the only native Kansan and only Native American to hold the post, as well as the first person of acknowledged non-European ancestry, the first American of significant Native American ancestry to be elected to such high office. Curtis decorated his office with Native American artifacts and posed for pictures wearing Indian headdresses. Curtis was the first vice president to take the oath of of office on a Bible in the same manner as the president, since he employed a woman as secretary to the vice president, instead of the customary man. He scored another minor first. Lola M. Williams of Columbus, Kansas, who had been working for Curtis for some time, was one of the first women to enter the Senate floor, traditionally a male monopoly. Later years, after the stock market crash in 1929, the problems of the Great Depression led to the defeat of the Republican ticket in the next election. Democrat Franklin D. Roosevelt was elected as president by a margin of 57% to 40% in 1932. Curtis's term as vice president ended on March 4, 1933, and he was succeeded by John Garner after politics. Curtis decided to stay in Washington, D.C., to resume his legal career, as he had a wide network of professional contacts from his long career in public service. He died there on February 8, 1936 from a heart attack by his wishes. His body was returned to his beloved Kansas and buried next to his wife at the Topeka Cemetery. Legacy and honors. He was featured on the cover of Time magazine, December 20, 1926 and June 18, 1928, while serving as U.S. Senator from Kansas. Full-length articles discussed his life and politics. He was featured as vice president on the cover of Time, December 5, 1932. His house in Topeka, Kansas has been listed on the National Register of Historic Places and designated as a state historic site. The Charles Curtis House Museum is now operated as a house museum. See also Curtis Act of 1898. List of chairpersons of the College Republicans. List of people on the cover of Time magazine, 1920s, December 20, 1926 and June 18, 1928. List of people on the cover of Time magazine, 1930s, December 5, 1932. References. Carrot McKee, Scott. 4 February 2014. Charles Curtis, America's Indian Vice President. Cherokee One Feather. Retrieved 20 June 2016. History, Embracing Events, Institutions, Industries, Counties, Cities, Towns, Prominent Persons, etc. Standard Publishing Company, P. Southeast Missourian, February 8, 1936 p. Proceeded. Joseph L. Bristow, U.S. Senator Class 3 from Kansas. March 4, 1915 to March 3, 1929. Served alongside William Howard Thompson. Arthur Capper succeeded. Case Broderick Member. 1928-1932 succeeded. Wesley L. Jones, Washington, V.E. Vice Presidents of the United States. John Adams, Thomas Jefferson, Aaron Burr, George Clinton, Elbridge Gerry, Daniel D. Tompkins, John C. Calhoun, Martin Van Buren, Richard Mentor Johnson, John Tyler, George M. Dallas, Millard Fillmore, William R. King, John C. Breckinridge, Hannibal Hamlin, Andrew Johnson, Schuyler Colfax, Henry Wilson, William A. Wheeler, Chester A. Arthur, Thomas A. Hendricks, Levi P. Morton, Adlai Stevenson I. Garrett Hobart, Theodore Roosevelt, Charles W. Fairbanks, James S. Sherman, Thomas R. Marshall, Calvin Coolidge, Charles G. Dawes, Charles Curtis, John Nance Garner, Henry A. Wallace, Harry S. Truman, Alvin W. Barkley, Richard Nixon, Lyndon B. Johnson, Hubert Humphrey, Spiro Agnew, Gerald Ford, Nelson Rockefeller, Walter Mondale, George H. W. Bush, Dan Quayle, Al Gore, Dick Cheney, Joe Biden, Mike Pence. Elect V.E. United States Senators from Kansas. Class 2 Lane Ross, Caldwell Crozier, Harvey Plum, Perkins, Martin Baker, Burton Benson, Curtis Thompson, Capper Schoeppel, Pearson Kassebaum Roberts. Class 3 Pomeroy Ingalls, Peffer Harris, Long Bristow, Curtis Allen, McGill Reed, Darby Carlson, Dole Fromm, Brownback Moran. V.E. Presidents pro tempore of the United States Senate. Langdon Lee, Langdon Izzard H. Tazewell, Livermore Bingham, Bradford Reed Sedgwick, Lawrence Ross Livermore, Tracy Howard Hillhouse, Baldwin Bradley Brown, Franklin Anderson Smith, Bradley Millage, Greg Guyard, Pope Crawford Varnum, Guyard Barber, Guyard Macon Smith L. Tazewell White, Poindexter Tyler W. R. King, Southard Mangum Sevier Acheson W. R. King Acheson, Cass Bright Stuart Bright, Mason Rusk Fitzpatrick Bright, Fitzpatrick Foote Clark, Foster Wade Anthony Carpenter, Anthony Ferry Thurman Bayard, Davis Edmonds Sherman, Ingalls Manderson Harris Ransom Harris Fry. Office rotated 1911-1913. Bacon Curtis Gallinger Brandegee Lodge Clark Salisbury Cummins Moses Pittman W. H. King Harrison Glass McKellar Vandenberg McKellar Bridges George Hayden Russell Ellender Eastland Magnuson Young Magnuson Thurmond Stennis Bird Thurmond Bird Thurmond Bird Stevens Bird Inouye Leahy Hatch V.E. United States Senate Majority Leaders Lodge Curtis Watson Robinson Barkley White Lucas McFarland Taft Nolan Johnson Mansfield Bird Baker Dole Bird Mitchell Dole Lott Dashley Frist Reed McConnell VE Republican Party leaders in the United States Senate Lodge: Curtis Watson, McNary, Austin McNary, White, Wary, Bridges, Taft, Nolan, Dirksen, Scott Baker, Dole. Lott, Frist, McConnell. VE United States Senate Majority Whips: Lewis, Curtis, Jones, Fess, Lewis, Minton, Hill, Wary, Myers, Johnson, Saltonstall, Clements. Mansfield, Humphrey, Long, Kennedy, Byrd, Cranston, Stevens, Simpson, Cranston, Ford, Lott, Nichols, Reed, Nichols, Reed, McConnell, Durbin, Cornyn. VE United States Senate Minority Whips: Wadsworth, Curtis, Jerry, Shepard, Hebert, Vacant, 1935-1944, Wary, Lucas, Saltonstall, Clements, Saltonstall, Dirksen, Kuchel, Scott, Griffin. Stevens, Cranston, Simpson, Ford, Reed, Nichols, Reed, Nichols, Reed, Durbin, Lott, Kyle, Cornyn, Durbin. VE Republican Party Whips in the United States Senate: Wadsworth, Curtis, Jones, Fess, Hebert, Vacant, 1935-1944, Wary, Saltonstall, Dirksen, Kuchel, Scott, Griffin, Stevens, Simpson, Lott, Nichols, McConnell, Lott, Kyle, Cornyn. VE Chairman of the United States Senate Committee on Indian Affairs, Full Committee, 1820-1947, Holmes, Johnson, Benton, H. White, Troop, H. White, Sevier, Moorhead, A. White, Sevier, Bagby, Acheson, Sebastian, Doolittle, Henderson, Harlan, Buckingham, Allison, Koch, Dawes, Jones, Pettigrew, Thurston, Stewart, Clapp, Gamble, Stone, Ashurst, Curtis, Spencer.